The Bible nowhere teaches that this age will see the conversion of the world and that the world will be getting better and better as time goes on. Instead, the Bible teaches that the world will grow progressively more wicked and godless and worse until it will culminate in the last great world war called the Battle of Armageddon. So terrible will this time of trouble be that except for the sudden intervention of God, all life would perish from this earth. This period of unprecedented violence, war, and death is called in Scripture the time of tribulation. The Bible also teaches that the church, the body of Christ, will be caught away with Christ in the air before that terrible day of the Lord breaks upon the earth. For our scripture today, we'd like to have you turn in your Bibles, which we trust you have open before you again, to the 21st chapter of the Gospel according to Luke and verse 36. Luke chapter 21 and verse 36. Watch ye therefore and pray always that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. Now our Lord Jesus in this chapter has been telling his disciples about the course of this age and some of the signs which would indicate the nearness of his second coming again. And he says in verses 25 to 28 of Luke 21, "And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh." Now this description by our Lord Jesus of a coming day of trial, suffering, violence, and despair is known in the Bible as the tribulation of the last days, so voluminously described all through the Word of God, and which is the subject of almost the entire book of the Revelation, the last book of the Bible. It is variously called in the Bible the tribulation, the day of the Lord, the day of vengeance of our God, and the time of Jacob's trouble. This period of tribulation, unprecedented in all of human history, will immediately precede the public return of the Lord Jesus in the clouds of heaven to set up his long-promised, literal but postponed messianic kingdom here upon the earth. It will be a period of war and destruction and famine and pestilence with great deceptions under the rule of the devil man, the Antichrist. Jesus says it will be a day of distress of nations, a day of perplexity, a day of storms and violent disturbances in the weather and in the sea. Men's hearts will fail them for fear of the things which will come upon the earth. They will grope in darkness, not knowing whither to turn. Now, it must be very evident to all of you that the shadows of this tribulation are already extending over the world. Surely the nations are in perplexity today and in great distress. In this atomic age, with its terrible potentialities, possibilities, and implications of the atomic bomb, the nations are mad and fear has gripped the leaders of the world on every hand. How they would welcome some great super statesman who could give them a seemingly infallible recipe for enduring peace and for staving off destruction. And just such a man will appear someday on the scene of action here on the earth, only to prove to be an impostor and a deceiver, and to plunge the world finally into the worst war of all history, culminating in the Battle of Armageddon. Now, in view of these solemn predictions, Jesus, therefore, warns his followers and says in Luke 21:34, "And take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and the cares of this life, and so that day, that is the day of earth's judgment, come upon you unawares. For as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the earth." Notice that this day of the earth's great tribulation will be universal and extend over the entire earth. Well, while it will center in its intensity and focus upon the land of Palestine and upon the nation of Israel, it will, however, extend over the entire world. Jesus makes this perfectly clear when he says that it shall come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth, Luke 21:35. Not a single individual who will be living on this earth at that time will be able to escape the judgment of God. It will come upon all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. And then follows a verse in the discourse of our Lord Jesus,
which is the one and the only bright spot in the entire dismal picture, a verse so arresting, so startling, yet withal so comforting and reassuring that we do not want to rush over it, but call your special attention to it. Please open your Bible, if you do not already have it open, and turn to Luke 21:36 and rivet your eyes on this verse. Here it is again, the same verse with which we opened this message. Watch ye therefore, and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. Now if we had no other passage in the entire Bible assuring us that we will not have to pass through this tribulation, this one single verse from Luke 21, all alone, standing by itself, would positively clinch the fact that the church will be raptured and caught out before that terrible day of the Lord sets in. We simply cannot understand how any careful reader of the Scripture can teach that the church must pass through all, or even through a very small part, of this tribulation period in the light of this Scripture. The Scriptures are replete and abound with dozens of passages assuring us that before the judgment of God falls on the nations in the tribulation, the church will be raptured and taken out. How subtle is the deception of the enemy of our souls in causing honest, sincere, and earnest men to doubt this blessed hope and to teach that the church will be in this day of the Lord while God has promised to keep us from that awful, awful time of sorrow. Men will turn heaven and earth upside down and twist and wrest and pervert the Scriptures in an effort to get themselves into a tribulation which God has already definitely promised to spare us from and to keep us safe. This verse, therefore, in Luke 21:36 silences, we believe, every argument. We invite you to study it very, very carefully. First of all, we must all agree that this verse teaches clearly and without any question or misunderstanding that there will be a company of people who will escape the tribulation. We quote again the verse because of its tremendous importance. Watch ye therefore, and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. Now notice carefully several very important things. First, there will be some people living on the earth at that time who will escape this period of sorrow. Secondly, these will escape all of the tribulation, and not only part of it, for it says to escape all these things. Third, these things, the expression these things, refers back to the things described by our Lord in the previous verses of this chapter in the context, and is the time of great tribulation. Fourth, when these things occur, this company who will escape will be with their Lord, for, says Jesus, they shall stand before the Son of Man. Now the only thing for us to determine, therefore, is who does Jesus refer to as escaping all these things? Everyone must agree, I'm sure, that there will be some, according to the clear teaching of this verse, who will be watching and praying and so will escape, according to the promise of the things described in this chapter. Now there are, of course, only three possibilities, for there are only three classes of people, scripturally, dispensationally, in the world today. Paul classes all men on the earth as either Jews or Gentiles or believers. In 1 Corinthians 10:32 we read, 1 Corinthians 10:32, give none offense, neither to the Jews, nor to the Gentiles, nor to the church of God. Now, this is the Apostle Paul's scriptural classification of humanity in this present dispensation of grace. The question, therefore, is, which group of these three does Jesus refer to as being found worthy to escape all these things which are coming upon the earth in the tribulation period, which is the subject of Luke 21. Surely we should have no difficulty in determining the answer. By a simple process of elimination, we ought to be able to put our finger definitely upon the one company whom the Lord promises will be worthy to escape these days. Now, first of all, we know that Israel will not escape. For this period of tribulation is definitely and specifically the time of Jacob's trouble. It is a time when Israel shall endure her greatest persecution under the reign of their false Messiah. 2/3 of the nation will, according to prophecy, perish, and only the remnant of believing Israel will be supernaturally brought through, converted to their Messiah, to enter into the Messianic kingdom reign with him. No, we know that Israel is not referred to as the group to whom the Lord refers as escaping the tribulation. Neither does Jesus refer to the Gentile nations, for it will be the day of the judgment of the nations upon the earth. All unbelievers will enter the tribulation period, the great majority of them perishing in that period, and only a remnant converted, most of whom will be slain for the testimony of the Lord Jesus and be resurrected again before the kingdom reign of our Savior. This then, by a simple process of elimination, leaves only the church as the sole possibility fitting into the picture of our Lord Jesus Christ. Israel will pass through the tribulation. The unconverted world will perish in the tribulation. And so Jesus could have referred to only one single group, the church. All true believers in him, the body of Christ, will be taken out. To the question, therefore, will the church pass through the tribulation? Jesus says, no, 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 for they will be spared by being caught away before that day breaks upon a wicked world. This is the clear teaching of Jesus' words in our text. And, I repeat, if there were no other revelation in the Bible, this alone would be enough for me to establish the absolute fact of a pre-tribulation rapture. Now, we believe that much of the misunderstanding in regard to this question of the pre-tribulation rapture is due to a failure to distinguish between tribulation in the general sense as it's used in the Word of God, and the specific time called the tribulation, also referred to as the day of the Lord. It is true that the Bible teaches everywhere that Christians during this dispensation may have to suffer tribulation for the sake of the testimony of Christ. We also recognize the fact that Christians in the past have suffered great tribulation and persecution because of their faith in the Lord Jesus. And it is possible that if the Lord should not come soon, that we too may have to seal our testimony with our blood. But this tribulation is only spoken of as the general experience of all believers in every age. However, when the Lord speaks about the tribulation, he definitely sets it aside as being something different and distinct from tribulation in the general sense. Our Savior, in speaking about this period of the earth's greatest sorrow, says, now notice this, you probably have overlooked it, it will be a time such as never was before, and such as will never be repeated. He therefore sets it aside by itself, in a category, all by itself, as being different from anything that has ever preceded it or anything that will ever follow it. Of course, we admit and acknowledge that the Bible has not promised the believer freedom from tribulation and persecution and trouble and sorrow. On the contrary, our Lord has definitely told us, in this world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world, John 16:33. However, when our Savior speaks in Matthew 24, Luke 21, Mark 13, about the tribulation, he's referring to something entirely different than the ordinary experience of believers. Unless we bear this in mind, nothing but confusion can and will result. Now it is in view of this coming day of trouble and sorrow that our Lord warns his disciples, watch ye therefore, and pray always that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. And so our question in closing again is, are you watching? Are you praying? Do you belong to that company who will be caught away into heaven without dying should Jesus come today, and he may? If not, if you're not a believer, then you will be left behind to face the awful judgments of God, to perish in the awful day of the Lord, and then spend eternity in outer darkness. but to every one of you how I thank God for this another opportunity. Jesus still offers salvation before it is forever too late. We are to be on the watch for the coming of the Lord, and also for the deception with regard to the truth of the coming of the Lord. It is the only thing, I repeat again, that we are urged to watch for, and any day it may happen. For, says the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 15, we shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. That event, the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, will be the most sudden event in all of history. Notice that Paul says it will be in the twinkling of an eye. He doesn't say in the winking of an eye. That implies time, but in the twinkling of an eye. How long do you think it takes to twinkle your eye? That quick it will be over. One of these days, just as sure as God is in heaven, just as sure as the word of God is the truth, just as sure as Jesus came the first time, suddenly he will come the second time. Shout from the air, and with the blast of a trumpet, wake the dead in Christ, who shall all come forth without exception. And then in the twinkling of an eye, living believers will be suddenly changed and caught up to meet the Lord in the air, leaving all the rest of the unbelievers behind. Then gross darkness shall come upon the people. Great deception shall grip the masses of humanity. And I don't like to say this, but I must. In faithfulness to my commission, those of you who are listening to this broadcast now and have the opportunity of receiving Christ and preparing for that day, when that moment breaks, the door of opportunity will shut for you forever. You will never have another chance. There will be an opportunity for those who've never heard the gospel. Multitudes will be saved in the tribulation period who have never heard the blessed story of the death and the resurrection of Christ. But to those who have heard and have willfully rejected, it will be the end of their opportunity. And now listen, one of these days, Jesus is coming. Men may scoff, they may laugh, they may reject, they may say, well, the ages have passed by, nothing has happened, but he's coming. He's coming. And one of these days, suddenly, it'll all be over. And then, too late for you. But listen, it's not too late now. You can still settle it. Won't you bow your head where you are right now before your radio? Look into his face and say, Lord, I believe thy word. I accept the record given in that word concerning thy son, that he died for me, that he gave his life for me, and that he offers me now resurrection life through faith in him. And then call upon him, ask him to save you, and then believe it. Trust it, because God says it. We'll be praying for you, and we'd love to hear from you. If you receive Christ as your Savior, won't you drop us a line and tell us? We'll correspond with you. We'll send you literature. We'll try and refer you to a good Bible-believing, gospel-preaching church, if we know of one in your neighborhood, and help you in every possible way to become a soul winner for Christ. But settle it now. Our Father, we come to thee in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and pray that thou wilt take our feeble efforts and our stumbling speech and by thy Holy Spirit empower it. Convict men and women and save them for Jesus' sake. Amen.